Hi, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Monster Party.
Monster Party.
Yeah. I'm so excited we're having a party.
Clang, 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 clang. I'm making party sounds.
I thought that was a Judy Garland move or something. This particular episode of Monster Party, before we get into that, we probably should introduce ourselves.
Yes.
I'm Matt Weinhold.
I believe I am Shawn Sheridan.
I'm Larry Strothe.
And I'm James GONIS.
And this is Monster Party, and the theme of our show today is fantasy.
Fantasy.
Fantasy. Anything can happen. A world of magic. fuck it.
It's a big topic.
It is a big, just a panoramic topic.
Broad.
And so what we did is we brought in an expert.
Fantasy expert.
A fantasy expert, my friend, fantasy enthusiast.
Better than, yes.
Jackie KASHIAN.
Welcome
to me.
Of Dork Forest fame.
Jackie KASHIAN.
We are so happy to have you here.
Thank you.
DorkForest.com. Jackie KASHIAN. Yeah, hi. You guys have been a font of chitter chat as we're prepared for this. We've gone all over. We've gone all over between monsters and science fiction, and then
Working Girl.
And then Working Girl.
We talked about Working Girl.
Things got a little tense.
It fits in the theme of fantasy, because the fantasy is that's a good movie.
Before we get emails and calls from people that are going to disagree with you, because I know there will be many.
Before Mike Nichols,
Working Girl is a good movie, but I think we need to focus on our topic, which is
our listeners have already tuned out.
Right.
So
we're okay. So fantasy. I guess the first question really is, what is fantasy? What
good question?
What really
separates it from
sci-fi, hard sci-fi, horror?
Because horror movies especially sort of have kind of a crossover a little bit sometimes into the world of fantasy. You could say that a vampire movie is also fantasy.
Remember the Puppet Crystal movie?
Oh, the Dark Crystal.
That was fantasy.
Yeah.
And yet, Creep Factor 11. Right?
Yeah, there's a horror quality to it.
Yeah, there's a horror quality.
Or Legend has the crazy
sexies, right?
Yeah, definitely nightmarish images and horror type. Mm-hmm.
Although I can only get so afraid of puppets, you know?
Matt, those puppets were pretty darn creepy. As a matter of fact, there's a scene when one of the Skeksis in that movie is dying. And do you remember, Jackie, do you remember this shot?
Yeah.
And he's in the bed, and some of the Skeksis kind of come up around, they're all kind of around him, and they're all, when's he going to die?
Yeah.
And the Skeksis is looking at him, goes, and he had these hideously terrifying eyes and that big beak and stuff. And I saw that as a kid, and that freaked me out.
It was freaky. But then the good news is they found the golden ticket in the Willy Wonka thing, and then the grandpa got out of that bed.
That is scarier.
Yeah, that was
the
terrifying.
Fact that they had to eat cabbage soup, that was the scary part.
That's fantasy,
movie.
Right,
Jackie,
there.
I think we're getting the movies mixed up.
Right, I might have digressed.
That is fantasy, though. But Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory
is also fantasy.
Sure.
But definitely.
But
with
not
horrific images, by the way.
Horrific images.
Yeah, Sean's a little hot.
Oh, well.
Oh, sorry about that.
Yes, you know what?
Very good looking.
You should be.
Very good looking
Super
man.
Super Fox.
Very good looking.
And well played.
But would you say
the capris, I think, really sold it for me.
Charlie and Chocolate Factory is also considered like a horror film. Some people think of it as that.
For little kids,
For bad kids. If you think about it, there's a bunch of terrible things that happen to each of the other kids in that film. You get one kid who could literally drown. I mean, he falls into the chocolate thing, gets sucked up that tube. God knows where he's going to go.
I think there was some controversy when the movie was originally released. I mean, my grandmother advised my mother against taking us to the matinee on that basis.
Really?
Yeah.
It definitely has like dark moments, especially as a little impressionable little kid, you know. But that's what I like about it now, that it holds up so well as an adult to watch too.
Especially
compared to the remake too.
But the fantasy I liked it when I saw it, but it does not hold up. I'll tell you something.
Really
Why? I like Johnny Depp. I like it when I saw it, the remake. I genuinely enjoyed it.
The reimagined.
Right, and then I bought it, and I accidentally watched it again, and now I have a new coaster. Because it is not good.
I was so disappointed.
It was just a different interpretation. I mean, when you think about different interpretations of like, when you see one version of True Grit, and you see another version of True Grit, both of those can have qualities that are good and crap. So
well, and also the Johnny Depp's doing this weird like Michael Jackson impersonation. In it's a like way, he's just this creepazoid. He's not with Gene Wilder. You got the idea that he is this volatile genius, but has a method to his madness.
But right. charming too, and magical at the same time. Yeah. He can turn, but like not right.
And nobody really gets hurt at the end. And,
right, and he wasn't. And Gene Wilder's character wasn't broken as a person.
Yeah,
right.
They gave him a backstory.
Right. Yeah. The backstory of Johnny Depp is that he's a broken person. Yeah. And now he's
backstory is what they do all every movie now. You have to have.
Yeah. I don't need to know that about you.
Nope.
Yeah.
The thing that bugs me too is it in a way it kind of seemed like they're kind of making fun of the charm of the classic one. That's what really bugged me about it.
Would it feel a little hipstery to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Why does it have to be so hipster? Yeah.
In the documentary of the classic one, mm-hmm. and Gene Wilder is asked about that the great last line that he has. Do you, Charlie, remember what happened to the man who got everything he wanted? And he goes, no. He lived happily ever after. That is such a great line. And that line was thrown by the writer as when they really didn't have a last line.
Right.
And that is, it just strikes a chord in everybody. And, mm-hmm. and I just love that line so much.
It's so sweet.
And then, but I think with the Tim Burton one, it's just, it is like, oh, we're just going to throw that all out the window. And,
it's a cynicism. It's not cool. Yeah. Did you guys see the Fantastic Mr. Fox?
Yes, yes, I did. Animated.
Yes.
Animated.
Enjoy that.
George Clooney.
It had a hipster vibe, but it was also super sweet.
Sweet, yeah. Mm-hmm. It was sort of like the Fox Rise of the Planet of the Apes. There was like, you know that like at some point the foxes are going to take over. They're going to turn against their human masters.
It's the rats of Nim.
You know, the difference here is the guys who did the first the Wonka film. I mean, that's a film that I think will withstand the test of time. I mean, this will go down like
it's no working
like
girl.
The Wizard of Oz.
I agree.
Or even the first Star Wars. But this is a film that will last forever. But the Johnny Depp one, totally forgetful. It's kind of an event film. It's a film that everyone gets into.
I'm never going to forget the $26 I spent on it.
where did you see it?
I think I got it in Blu-ray at Target.
I saw it with the Sultan of Brunei.
I'm sure that this is always the argument, but like, why even bother touching such a cherished classic if you have the money? Why not let Burton do an original
film? That's such a great point. It's like, there's so many movies like that where you go like, why? You made it right the first time.
Yeah.
Don't make it again. Not broken.
Yeah.
It's fine.
It's so strange.
What I would like to know is like, when it comes to the fantasy genre, I know that you like Lord of the Rings and what are some of your
books?
The books. You're not crazy about the movies?
Really?
No.
Really? Why?
Really?
Right. Well, here's what I've recently come to a realization. First of all, I might also be alone in liking the Hobbit movies better than the Lord of the Rings movies.
Okay.
Wow. And it's because I think Peter Jackson finally sort of got the Hobbit situation. In the Lord of the Rings, the books are about the Hobbits, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
The movies are about Aragorn. Hmm. And I don't care about Aragorn, and there the discrepancies from the books were so great. So if I can watch the Lord of the Rings movies, forgetting that I've ever read the books,
right?
I thoroughly enjoy them as a very fancy Willow, as the fanciest Willow in the world. Mm-hmm. Now the Hobbit, I was trying to like. I think of the Hobbit and the Lord of the Rings books as literature,
right?
Mm-hmm. That does not make those movies films. Mm-hmm. It makes those movies movies. Mm-hmm. And I have to cut Peter Jackson some slack and just go, okay, because he nails the look of the world.
The feel of it. Right.
Yeah.
Well, you're truly immersed in the world.
Yeah.
You know, opposite of you, having not read the books, familiar with them, but not read the books, I enjoyed the trilogy.
He has never read a book. Only the Bible.
You know, and Jackie,
another
thing,
fantasy.
I mean, Jackie, the other thing you have to remember, too, is like every book, there's so much detail that goes into every book. I mean, it's virtually impossible.
Don't even.
No. It's virtually impossible.
Faramir?
To throw
Sam
so
never,
much
never
stuff.
Tries to steal the ring. I cannot.
Can I just say, the fact that they got rid of all the songs makes me kind of in love with it.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, the thing is because when you first read The Lord of the Rings, you don't read. I don't care who is lying to you and telling you that the thing that they loved the first time they read The Lord of the Rings were the songs. I'm like, shut up. You read the songs because you want there to be more Lord of the Rings, and you've only read it six times, and then you're like, well, what's the song about? And
well, then you read the song. You get the feeling like, you know, he's like, Tolkien was really this like frustrated songwriter that like, maybe I'll just slip these in.
Dude was a linguist, right? Yeah. He was a total linguist. He was known to have said things like, the only way to become a philologist, which is a linguist, is to go to Germany and study with the Germans for 12 years. And you're like, stop talking. That isn't a thing.
Hey, I am German. And I was with Germans for 12 years. Right, but you have to go. I do not suggest it.
Well, would he recommend you also go back to 1907 and do it
even
then.
More so then? Yeah.
Now, Jackie, I do want to ask this though, because you know some people think that Peter Jackson's The Hobbit is the first Hobbit movie. It isn't.
Right. No, because of the sure. Rankin and Bass business.
Exactly, back in 1977.
Did you like those?
No.
You didn't like that one?
No, I really enjoyed the books. And here's the thing about the books, though, is that they'll always be there, right? Yes. I mean, yeah. I don't have to shit on the movies or in the cartoons.
But it kind of sounds like you are.
Yeah, right. It does.
And if people want to be introduced to those worlds via that, that's fine. And same with Harry Potter. Same with, Lord of the... Ender's Game. Hunger Games. Here's what I don't like about Hunger Games. Revenge fantasy. I like my heroes to be better people than me.
I love revenge fantasy because I'm never going to do that. Right. So in my fiction, I want Punisher. I want a guy to come in and kill everyone. Well, that's what I'm looking for.
That's why the Hulk, in the Avengers movie, when Ruffalo says, that's my secret, is I'm always angry. I was like, I finally get every Hulk fan. Every Hulk fan in the world is angry all the time, and they're trying to keep it together.
If I was the Hulk, I would never not be the Hulk. I would always be the Hulk. There'd be somebody like, don't mention junior high school. You wouldn't like me when I think of junior high school.
But is Hulk fantasy or is Hulk something? Ooh, good question. Hulk something else.
Superheroes. Superhero genre.
That's a very good point.
I think he's more of superhero area.
Well, isn't the superhero genre is fantasy by extension because you can project yourself as a superhero.
But that's a fantasy. But there's a fine line because
it's different kinds of fantasy.
Because a mutant, for example, is sort of like a scientific explanation for superpowers, whereas you know, the Superman origin is kind of like, you know, because in the different sun, I'm like, no, I don't think so. This doesn't really hold up, but it's fine. It was like, it was written in the 30s, so it's
right, but
it's
there's,
okay.
And in those comic book universes, there's always that, the like the science brain, like the fantasy, the four. I don't read that guy. The Fantastic Four.
Fantastic Four?
Yeah. I'm so sorry. That's the only one I don't know. The Final Fantasy Four guy. It's like the Final 16.
The Funky Fresh Four? What?
NCAAP.
The Fabulous Five.
Fabulous Five. The Secret Six. And,
or the Sinister Six.
The Sinister Six. I like the Secret Six better, the DC version.
Oh, okay.
And that was amazing. Gail Simone. And but the thing is I do think that it is fantasy, but there's all kinds of different fantasy, right? I mean, there's the dragon fantasy.
Yeah.
And then there's, which usually involves magic. And, right. And it could be, you know, Ursula Le Guin, you know.
Medieval. Yeah.
What might be the whole thing is a coming of age thing, but does that make The Chosen a fantasy, right? Did you guys ever see The Chosen? It's a story about Israel.
Robbie
and the coming
Benson?
Of, oh, yeah,
yeah
but back Robbie in the Benson. 70s? Or, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, here's a question.
So then would ice castles be considered fantasy? Or?
Because maybe.
There's no way he could skate that good. Right.
You know, he did do the voice of the Beast in Beauty and the Beast,
that's
though.
That's true.
You know, which
he's a
is
man.
Fantasy.
So speaking of sci-fi versus fantasy, this is always a question that comes up.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Constantly, every day.
Here it comes.
Is the Star Wars universe, are the Star Wars films more fantasy or more hard science fiction? Compared to, like, say, Star Trek, which kind of is usually considered more science fiction.
Yeah.
Well, I think Star Trek's science fiction, right?
Star Trek is science fiction, whereas...
Until they get on the holodeck.
you could kind of... sure, you know, sure. At least they're trying.
Right,
but,
right.
But when you get to Star Wars, like, started off as kind of, like, space opera, science fantasy,
yeah.
Until we got into the new movies where they explain the Force.
And made it all science.
Yeah, which normally I would like that. Like, yeah. I prefer kind of hard science fiction movies.
Sure. Okay.
But the minute they did that and explained it, then it ruined everything.
And totally.
Nobody wanted the Force.
But even before that, even if you go back to the first Star Wars film, the idea of, like, a dogfight in space, if you think of it in a hard science fiction way, there's no such thing, right? There's not, you know what I mean? Because you can't do those kind of moves in space. No, seriously, if you're thinking
about... that's true, but that's more of a artistic license thing rather than a thematic or
Because maybe they'll figure out a way to do that. Maybe they will.
Maybe they have really good science.
Maybe the best science in the world.
Well, maybe one way of looking at it is a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away makes it more of a fairy tale, whereas traditional science fiction was always supposed to be forward-thinking, like this could happen in 25 or 100 years.
Yeah, right. Star Wars isn't really like this. It is more in a way a fantasy, you're right, a fantasy galaxy.
That fairy tale thing is an interesting thing, because I do think that fantasy tends to have more of a moral, tends to have more of a fairy tale kind of Grimm's kind of, oh, well, you don't want to, you gotta remember to have your friends, you gotta remember to be honorable, you know, the last starfighter, you know, you gotta believe in yourself, you guys. Rise of the Guardians, right? You gotta believe, Jack Frost had to believe in himself, man.
That's right. My wife loves the last starfighter. It's like her favorite sci-fi movie.
But that would be considered fantasy?
Try to remake that.
A little bit,
there's
no
way to remake the last starfighter.
No, it is what it
someone's
is.
Someone's playing their game on the phone.
Yeah.
And the what if we man
do a,
shows up.
What if we do a prequel to first Starfighter?
Robert Preston.
It has to have a really good backstory to him.
Because I wrote some fan fiction if you guys want to read it. It was assigned parts.
It was a crossover with Tron and Last Starfighter.
I add Blake from Blake 7 to round it out.
Blade Runner? Science fiction?
Science fiction.
Science fiction.
Science fiction.
Okay. Yeah. Definitely science fiction.
Tron?
That's more fantasy,
more
I think.
Okay.
I think so. Yeah.
But leans towards science fiction.
I was going to say science fiction. Yeah. I mean, you get zapped into a computer.
Yeah, but that's absurd.
A big leap. No, it's... Yeah. You know, maybe in your...
It could happen.
Yeah, you know, they're working on that, Matt. They're working on that.
Yeah, I want to say, too, though, as far as fantasy movie franchises go, I think the Lord of the Rings movies are more successful as a fantasy franchise than, say, the new Star Wars films. You know, like...
Are they?
I mean, creatively more successful.
Creatively,
absolutely. You know, than what they did with like the later Star Wars films.
Yeah,
you know,
those
like,
movies are just a giant shit on all of us. Like,
pretty much.
Stop hitting me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Thank you. Really, you need that much more money?
Yeah.
Stop. Give this to somebody else.
Well, get ready for the next wave.
J.J. Abrams, which will be another level of horror.
Now there are a lot of people. We're crapping all over this.
I'm living in hope. For the new one.
Always.
Think of it this way. Could they be worse than the last three?
Very good point.
You know, and also, I have to admit, I really did not like the first J.J. Abrams Star Trek movie.
Yeah.
However, I enjoyed the second one.
Which felt
not a classic, not a masterpiece. No, does not hold a candle to the original Wrath of Khan.
Okay, yeah.
No way.
I've had arguments with this people because I also enjoyed it.
Yeah, I mean, like
it's a throwaway kind of movie. Like
it
I don't
is.
Know if I want to. I don't know if I want to see it ever
exactly.
Again.
Wrath of Khan I've seen probably 50 times, and I'll see 50 more times.
Yeah.
There's something about. I mean, just they hold
it's
up.
So
but,
great.
But I was not. I kind of enjoyed Star Trek 2.
Yeah, because
the
first
like
one
the,
was terrible.
The running and the running, and then there was some more running.
There was a lot of
running. The first one.
Yeah.
Was that the first one where there was the running?
The first one, there's a lot of
second
running.
The second one had a lot of running.
There's running, too. There's a lot of running.
Yeah, isn't Cumberbatch floating towards the... Aren't they both Pine and Cumberbatch?
That was kind of fun. Come on.
Right, no, but they were going towards it, and Scotty
was, like
was
the luge.
Running, but he was running forever.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Remember that? And do you know where they shot that? At the Budweiser plant up in Van Nuys.
Oh, really? Wow. Yeah.
See, that's why I like that movie.
There is...
I hated in the first start, we're taking a slow... This is what Monster Party is all about.
Right.
Divergent little...
You weed off.
Right, but we reconvene.
Right.
But there's that scene in the first Star Trek movie where Chekhov goes, you know, there's something wrong with the ship, and he goes, I know how to do this! And he's running all the way through the ship.
Yes.
I'm like, what if there was a button that maybe you pressed?
Right, what if you could access that panel remotely?
Yeah.
Like you can your own home right now.
When they... Thank you. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
Good point.
Yeah, I can work my lights from my phone.
But you have to physically be there.
Yeah. Mm. And I like that. My other favorite thing too was the giant space drill. We have a drill.
Oh.
A drill.
Oh, sorry, I know. That's a big thing that you. The giant space.
All right. Anyway, so fantasy.
Yeah, fantasy.
So one thing you were saying about Tolkien and the Lord of the Ring movies, which because I feel like there's a little bit of a hate with the Lord of the Ring movies, but. It's, for example,
not even a little.
Okay,
wow,
a lot.
Wow.
All right. Well, there you go.
Yeah.
So
I own them all, by the way.
I was going to ask.
Love-hate relationship.
It's a love-hate relationship.
On Blu-ray and
like,
DVD and 3D.
Right, I had to buy them anyway, but all right.
So the movie The Shining.
Right.
Kubrick's The Shining is, I love that movie, and I read the book first, which is a great book, amazing book. Movie, completely different.
Right.
Okay. But a reimagining. I love the movie.
Right.
Because, as you said, I already have the book.
Right.
Kubrick went and did some crazy new thing.
Which is what Peter Jackson is doing with The Hobbit. That's what I like The Hobbit for.
Okay.
Is because he is reimagining The Hobbit. But the Hobbits are the heroes. The Hobbits, well, I mean, it helps because the guy playing Bilbo is such a better actor than the guy who played Frodo. Right?
He's great.
I love Martin Freeman.
But I will say in the second Hobbit movie, he is almost entirely dressed as Arthur Dent, which is hilarious because he's wearing kind of a tunic-y thing that looks like
he wears a bathrobe.
Yeah, it looks exactly like a bathrobe. And I was like, wait, you're mixing your movies.
Do they make slippers that big for the feet?
No, didn't
Zaphod Beeblebrox would know.
Don't they also integrate the Silmarillion into this Hobbit
trilogy?
No,
because they do not have the rights to the Silmarillion because Michael Tolkien or Christopher Tolkien is still alive.
And
Christopher Tolkien said, over my dead body.
Wow.
And
I just wasn't done reading it.
What do you think of the idea, though, the fact that they've been do you think it was a smart idea to, like, take the shorter book, which was The Hobbit,
right,
and expand it into three movies?
I think that he didn't – I don't know that he made that choice. I don't think that was a Peter Jackson choice. I think that
he didn't want to do them at all, I heard.
No.
Yeah, I think that was a studio choice. And what they are taking them – it's not from the Silmarillion. It's from the appendices from The Lord of the Rings.
Mm.
And there are – because they have the right to The Lord of the Rings because J.R.R. Tolkien sold them before he died. And so they get all this stuff that references stuff from the Silmarillion, but they get to kind of use it. And what I think is fascinating is the backstory about the dwarves. What I think is fascinating is an introduction of that the Toriel, the elf lady, I'm so fucking on board because she kicks ass and takes names and
you had me at elf lady.
Super good times. And it makes more sense. Like, if you see that second Hobbit movie and you see Legolas jumping around and it's goofy and silly, it has the because The Hobbit was written for children, or at least the first three quarters
right?
The last quarter, not so much. But because it was written for children, it has this silliness that Peter Jackson captures it in the barrel scene. I mean, literally, I'm slapping my knee when I'm watching that thing. I saw it twice. I saw it in 3D. I saw it in regular. And I was like, oh, he's really capturing something. But then I look back at it, and he's got Radagast in there, and there's no Radagast. There's two sentences in the entire everything. He's not even mentioned in the Silmarillion. So there's no reason. Anyway, we could just talk about it.
You know what? All I'm doing is just falling in love with you. That's all I'm doing.
Now, Jackie, if it makes you feel any better, I did not read the Lord of the Rings trilogy, but when I think back on the movies, I don't think as much about Aragorn. I tend to think of it as Frodo's story from the beginning to the end.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because there's so much problem with the way that, because Frodo at the end of it is so powerful at the end of the book, and at the end of the movies, he is so diminished and he is so beaten up by the ring, and he is beaten up by the ring in the books, but he has also grown into be one of the great. Like, he is on the same stature as Gandalf. Like, he has faced Sauron and, you know,
you don't see that in the movies, true.
Not at all.
Yeah, and he goes through hell and back, and like, you
and
feel
Sam-wise,
that in him.
And all he got was a t-shirt. Oh, all right. Pour yourself a fresh one, everybody.
Cheers.
What about the Ralph Bakshi adaptation?
Yeah, the Lord of the Rings.
Right. The
1978.
Their problem was too is they started to run out of money.
They did some of it.
And there was always this intention to continue on. Hopefully, it would be successful enough and it wasn't. It did okay, but not phenomenal business. They did a lot of rotoscoping in the film and stuff.
It was a lot of experimental animation.
Yeah,
there was.
I have to say, I am fascinated by that movie, and I think it's a really interesting watch.
It is,
yeah.
And a lot of people don't know this, but they made action figures of those main characters.
That's right.
They did.
They made Gandalf, Samwise, Frodo,
Ringwraith.
They made Gollum. Gollum and a ring wraith and Frodo's horse.
Back in 1978?
Yeah, back in 1978.
Those are pretty rare.
Yeah, yes, yes, and I will show them to you.
Oh my God. That's awesome.
The entire set, thank you very much.
Nice.
Let me tell you, but they're beautiful figures, but the figures, it's one of those things where it was like Star Wars had, you know, when Star Wars came out, they didn't have the toys ready, right. And Star Wars started
there's
that
like
whole,
a toy boom.
Exactly. So with Lord of the Rings, they were thinking, oh, I guess we got to make some figures, and they only made a few, but the film and the figures never really, you know, took off exactly. But if you do find them, I mean, they are pretty priceless.
That's awesome. You know, I don't remember the what's it called? I didn't. I've seen the animated. They're animated, correct?
Yeah.
I remember seeing parts of them and not being drawn in. Which did you love them? Were they great?
You know what I loved was the music.
Wasn't there also a Hobbit animated TV movie?
Yeah, that's the Rankin Bass one. Yeah.
No, but as well as the Lord of the Rings feature.
That was different, though. That was the... Right.
That was the...
Now, have you seen the movie... Speaking of Bakshi, have you seen the movie Wizards?
Oh, yeah.
Because that's another interesting...
That was pre...
No, see,
okay, that was pre, but that was pre Lord of the Rings.
Yeah,
which I fascist, the most.
No, it's against fascism,
and yet it was not. I watched that movie, and all I could think was, "I get it. Are you sitting next to me hitting me while you go get it? Get it?" I was like,
"But
Jesus
it's an interesting
Christ,
thing
dude.
To it's a beauty like those Bakshi's movies.
The images,
yeah, they're not like narratively they have something to be desired, but they're always fascinating."
The just, art?
Yeah, the visually. Art, the animation.
The kind of world.
And
like, you know, I
the
think
colors,
it's
otherworldly. And as a kid, you were a sophisticated kid when you saw that.
No, I just saw it. I saw it like 10 years ago. And the thing is
you just saw it 10 years ago?
No, I saw it 10 years ago, but here's what you got to realize about me, because I do not, like, I know a lot more people who are more visual than I am, and so when I see art that I consider to be weird... Not cool to say it because there's no such thing as weird art. Everybody's art is all equally valued. I don't get it. It was back at a time when I didn't get any art. Like I didn't really get it.
Okay.
And I remember because it was before I read comic books and I got to see a lot of different kinds of styles of art.
Okay.
And I had never studied art. I would go to art museums and I'd be like, oh, that looks like a Roman Colosseum. It looks cool. I bet you there'd be gladiators there. So, literally, that's what I was looking for cool scenes with horses.
Okay.
I was not an art aficionado. So the first time, like, I went to the Guggenheim,
yeah.
I went with my fella, Andy, who is he's an art nerd. He studied fine art and he has a degree in fine art. So we're going up the Guggenheim, spin, 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 and we're getting to super modern, right? And we get to a canvas that all it is a big black dot near one side of it. And I go, now here's where it all falls apart for me.
Yeah, but you're right there.
No, I see that.
That is bullshit.
I see that.
But wizards, I mean...
He explained the value of the black dot. He said that the value of the black dot was that was the first guy who created something called edge tension, knowingly created whatever. Who gives a shit? Because it does sound like bullshit. But the thing is, is when you look at a thing, you not only see the dialogue and the story and everything like that, you also see the art, and you know enough about different kinds of art to go, that is interesting and weird and I like it.
Okay.
And I looked at it and said, that is interesting and I don't like it. And so I was wrong. Mm-hmm. And now I should see Wizards again.
Okay. Well, let me just say something. This is, we've done a couple shows on like guilty pleasures.
Yes.
So,
oh, I got him.
That's what I want to know is like, see, because that Wizards is sort of a guilty pleasure because I think it's not like the greatest written movie, but it is fascinating to me. Mm-hmm. It is kind of
right.
Beautiful
from just a writing. It was not good.
No.
That's why I didn't
it. No, yeah. I hear you. But what I want to know is like, what are things that you are into? Like the things that you go, I know this isn't really great, but I can't help. Like,
Willow.
Like, did you love? Oh, well,
really?
Willow. Okay, there you go.
Willow is not good, and yet Willow, I own Willow, and I watch Willow.
That as a coaster?
I can't. No. Willow is painful for me.
Willow is hard for me, too.
Painful. I'll never watch that movie again.
Use the wand, Willow. Use the wand.
Bad. Bad.
It's my disappearing.
Wow, all of a sudden, it's like I'm in Willow.
It's the old pig trick.
Yeah, the old pig trick.
What did you think of the movie Krull?
Oh, I saw Krull.
Oh,
How many times did you hear that in your life?
Hey, everybody, let's talk Krull.
I just want to say, you know, they made there was a really cool Ben Cooper costume
of the Cyclops. Krull?
Yes.
Oh my God. Wow. Cyclops is stupid.
That must have been right as they were going out of business.
made them go out of business.
Exactly. The Krull years.
It was actually cool because it's a freaking Cyclops. Oh, it's a Cyclops.
Oh,
and
my
you
God.
Have to have two eyes.
Yeah.
Right? Eyes, like, right here.
But he could see his other eyes and he was always blinking and it was bad. It was stupid.
Mom, I want to be the Cyclops from Krull.
What was it about Willow that made you like it so much?
Oh, he was the greatest swordsman who ever was. That's why.
Okay.
And it also had what's his face in it, who I really like.
Val Kilmer.
Rick Overton?
Yes. Both of them. Daikini baby.
Wow.
No, because it was good action and it was very, I mean, I thought it was stylized. I liked the sets and I thought that there were some good fight scenes, and then there was
now you're describing what we like about wizards.
And that
okay.
That terrible two-headed dragon was terribly designed.
Okay, well,
and it was,
okay, speaking of dragons and, you know, creepy things, stuff, but what about
dragon?
Something like a,
oh, the two, it the, was
yeah,
terribly
that
designed.
Was a stupid looking monster.
But it looked like something out of Clash of the Titans.
You didn't like Clash of the Titans?
I love Clash of the Titans.
Okay. Yeah, Clash of the Titans is great.
Clash of the Titans is good. Yeah.
Larry almost became angry drunk.
I also liked Davy and Goliath when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah, totally.
I love Davy and Goliath.
Davy.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, that's fantasy.
Did I blow your whistle,
yeah.
Davy?
Like Charlie Brown and Peanuts, is that fantasy? This crazy dog who thinks that he can fly a plane? And
how do we get onto that?
It's fantasy!
I'm trying to go into the Harryhausen films, you know, the fantasy.
I think those definitely qualify as fantasy. Although some of his early ones, like 20 Million Miles to Earth and even Beast with 20,000 Fathoms, is more sci-fi horror.
Yeah. Yes.
But like Jason and the Argonauts, I would argue Jason and the Argonauts is probably one of the best fantasy films ever made.
That's a great
I love that one.
Yeah, very
Gulliver,
yeah.
Three Worlds of Gulliver.
Yeah,
Gulliver was great.
I love it.
First Man on the Moon, actually, even though it's kind of you would think sci-fi, but there is a fantasy element. The thing that makes the anti-gravity thing that makes the thing go to the moon. That's kind of fanciful.
Because that was is that H.G. Wells? So it's an H. In a way, it could be considered a fantasy.
Yeah,
I'm gonna call bullshit on this.
Are you gonna say it's more like it's the science of the time? He's trying to think of it
like
the
Jules Verne style.
Somebody made a thing.
No, I'm with you.
But definitely the Sinbad movies and all that. I mean, those
those are fine. But the thing is the real guilty pleasures, the real fantasy that has happened in my lifetime has been mostly Disney. And they're mostly animated.
For me, it's relationships.
Like, for example, which
Disney? Aladdin.
Okay.
Like Aladdin is one of my favorite.
Yeah, I think
Disney
all
movies.
That whole genre is fantasy. Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, I think so.
You know, and there's
Jungle Book.
Beauty
would that
the,
be?
Well, Jungle Book,
probably because of the talking animals.
Yeah,
but
the Incredibles maybe more a little more sci-fi-ish.
God,
maybe
I love the Incredibles, but it's so superhero sci-fi. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that's more sci-fi.
No
I'd say.
Capes.
Yes. But you would say something like Aladdin, Beauty and the Beast.
Beauty and the Beast.
Herbie the Love Bug is definitely science fiction.
But Rise, did you guys see Rise of the Guardians?
It looked interesting, but it kind of came and went pretty fast.
No,
I mean,
it was great.
Was it?
Really? Yeah, it was. I'm spacing his name.
M. Night Shyamalan?
Wilford Brimley. Tom Skerritt.
And Christopher Pine was in it. And he played Jack Frost. And it wasn't a Christmas movie, it wasn't an Easter. Huge Ackman played the Easter Bunny.
Wow.
And
it wasn't based on a toy line, right? It was like,
oh, I've got all the toys though. I got them all.
Maybe it wasn't based, it was an original. Was it based on books or?
No, I don't know what it was based on. I think it was based on a book, but the toys I ate it.
A Playboy show.
I went to McDonald's three times when I was on the road to get all the toys.
Really?
Wow. It was so gross. I did not feel well. I'd eaten three Happy Meals.
You know,
in
they'll
a day.
Just give you the toys.
I know
you can just buy the toys. Yeah. That bullshit rationalization to eat some shitty food doesn't work around here, sister.
Turns out I wanted to eat some shitty Starbucks.
Oh, I guess I got to eat these five Happy Meals.
Plastic Happy Meal.
I have a guilty pleasure. I know it's not necessarily a great movie, but it's Rankin Bass's Last Unicorn from 1982.
Oh, I remember that.
Medieval,
I saw that in the theater.
Sort of medieval fantasy.
Wow, I mean, I'm familiar with it.
Peter
haven't seen
Beale?
It.
Is that Peter Beale book?
Yes.
Okay. I've been trying to read that.
You know, it's just this combination of it. Alan Arkin does one of the voices, and Jeff Bridges, and he's a terrible singer, but they make him do a song, and there's just something about it I love, you know?
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
And it holds up. Have you seen it recently, the last 10 years?
Yeah, and it's got animation that was done by Toei Studios in Japan, which Rankin-Bass was doing a lot with Japan back then. But the whole thing looks like a Clairol Herbal Essence commercial from like the 70s.
Sounds great.
I'm sold. You sold me right there.
The unicorn had a great mane. That's what I remember.
Yeah. It was Mia Farrow. Yeah.
If you see one great mane movie this year.
The last unicorn.
Wow. But we got to get, if we're talking guilty pleasures, we got to get, like, what about stuff like... The Magic Sword, or Gary Lockwood.
Oh my God! Oh, I've heard.
Yeah.
Or Jack the Giant Killer, the original.
The original
Rutherford
Jack. Kerwin Matthews.
Yeah.
Or how about
kind of?
That's not a guilty pleasure.
How about?
That's
well,
cool.
that borders
that's
on good,
cool.
Right?
Yeah.
But what about Tom Thumb? Meets
Meet the Monsters
not Tom Thumb with
Tom Thumb and Little Red Riding Hood is that what it is?
There was a whole genre of I guess in the 60s they were Mexican films
Mexico had films.
Mexico. They were like these weird fantasy movies, and they had like Puss in Boots. And
this was the same producer who made the Mexican Santa Claus, right?
Yeah, like really weird kind of fever dream fantasy movies, incredibly cheaply made that poverty-stricken like productions that are just weird to watch and like disturbing to watch now.
Yeah.
With like weird like badly designed animal characters and they made like a bunch of them that there's like kind of based on fairy tales and fables and they're pretty obscure. There's not really like I don't think any of them have been really officially released.
Can you find these on YouTube?
I've got a 16mm.
Yeah, but they're pretty weird. Yeah, there's a series of Red Riding Hood ones. There was a series of Puss in Boots ones, and they're pretty strange.
You know what I want them to make? There's the book series that I would love them to make that Jasper Ford, he's Welsh, so he gets to have two F's in his name. F-F-O-R-D-E, Jasper Ford. And he has a series of, they're noir, but they're with... storybook characters like Humpty Dumpty is killed.
Really?
Yes.
That sounds kind of like that Lovecraft movie. There's a similar thing was a detective noir called Cast a Deadly Spell.
Oh, right. Yeah.
it was like
Dennis Hopper.
No, that was a later one. It was a Fred
Willard.
Ward? Fred Willard.
Fred Ward.
Wait, Fred Ward as like it was like a kind of a tough gumshoe.
Okay.
But it was like there was it was like a film noir kind of setting, but there was magic being used black magic.
Yeah, this Jasper Ford thing. It was Humpty Dumpty is killed, and Jack Spratt is the detective. He's a police officer.
Oh my gosh.
And he's got to figure out who
is it done
seriously.
He's got
to put all the pieces together.
Yeah, he's got to put all.
But
the
is it kind of done in a serious way or a satirical way?
It is done satirically, but it is one of the best mysteries I've ever. I was like, who the fuck did it? And so you're just going along, and then when the big reveal, you're like, oh.
But it's kind of like that reminds me of Fables.
Yeah,
Bill Willingham comic book.
Comic book, and Once Upon a Time ripped it off, and Once Upon a Time, and Alice in Wonderland, and but Fables is so good, and Jack of Fables.
Good. Jack of Fables is great too. Yeah, and, great comic book of
Bill Willingham.
Yeah, there's this sort of shadow community of fables, all the characters from storybooks, and they're hidden from humanity, and they're
they live
on
in New York.
Yeah, and they live in New York. And
sounds like Once Upon a Time really ripped us off. Then,
yeah,
and they're on the run because in their native land, there's this evil force that's taken over everything. Yeah,
the Emperor.
Yeah, and it's so good, very well written.
League of Extraordinary Gentlemen too.
Oh yeah,
alternate universe of fictional characters.
Yeah, except for that, it doesn't have Alan Moore's. I mean, Bill Willingham's a little curmudgeon-y, but he's more. Bill Willingham used to write porno. He used to write dirty comic books.
Haven't we all?
he wrote dirty comic books. It was called, wait for it, Ironwood.
If I ever do porn, that is going to be my name.
Is that a Pinocchio fable?
Pinocchio and Geppetto are in fables, and it's all Beauty and the Beast. Huh,
interesting.
And it's such.
And Pinocchio
is so
sort
well
of like
written.
A. Anti, like he's evil at one
he's
point.
He's just a little shit because
he's just
like,
an asshole.
Right, he's like, you realize I'm 10 years old and I want to get laid, but I can't.
Yeah,
I can't.
Oh, right. Wow, interesting.
Sounds horrible.
Oh my God.
So good.
We just Pinocchio. Ruined your Christmas.
You did. I think of Pinocchio's, you know.
Well, in the book, Pinocchio was a little shit, even the original Italian.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, they had to do all this stuff to get him to, like, be a real boy. Like,
right.
And, like, I think they made him a real boy because if he remained a puppet, he'd take over the world. He'd like like this unstoppable wooden killing machine.
That's true. You can't kill him.
I read the Kahlo Kaladi book when I was maybe nine.
You can't kill what's already dead.
Yeah.
No, he's a monster. It's a little wooden monster. I mean, he kills. This is the source material. I mean, he kills Jiminy Cricket.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
He burns down Geppetto's house.
Wait,
Tara, read the book. Go back to the source.
Wow.
I'm serious.
Are you serious?
He's not a fairy tale, really.
That's horrible.
It's horrible.
Sounds good.
Walt Disney doesn't want any part of the real story. <I don't
know. laughs> Boy, if you read the original story of the Aristocats, oh my God.
Oh my God, there's raping and...
Yeah. They'd rather stick with the original Song Lady of the in the South.
Those cats have a snuff porn ring. They run out of their...
Hey, do you guys think the original Flipper movie is fantasy?
No, it's science fiction. Dolphins might be able to do that one day.
I don't even know if that's considered fantasy because it's a smart dolphin. It's not like the dolphin talks like in Days of the
Yes, Day of the Dolphin.
Day of the Dolphin.
My love spawn.
Yes, exactly. Flipper is just a smart dolphin. You know, and I don't know if that's really fantasy. I mean, that could be considered.
That's
a drama. It's a drama.
It's a slice of life about a boy and his dolphin friend.
Exactly.
That's all it is.
Shouldn't we all have a dolphin friend?
Yeah, it's a dark fantasy.
maybe in your mind.
Where did you touch the dolphin? All right. Well, any last thoughts with this?
Keep going and going.
But one more round. Any fantasy? Let's do a last round of like fantasy things you would recommend.
Oh, right. Hmm.
Yeah.
Well, we haven't talked at all about Game of Thrones, which I actually don't watch, but I know it's really popular.
I don't watch it. I've tried to read it. I've tried to watch it. I've tried to listen to it on audiobook.
You know, I haven't watched it either, but perhaps we should recommend it because...
you know what? I have watched it, and I will recommend it, except for the last season and one episode, which was a lot of fun. Red Wedding was pretty fun, but everything else up to that was a bunch of people talking about their feelings, and I don't have them, so I can't relate.
I tried so hard because everyone was like, you should do it. And I read all the Hunger Games, but I haven't seen any of the movies. I hear the second movie was even better than the first movie. And
second one I enjoyed.
And the
first one...
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. The second one was fun.
And Ender's Game, is that science fiction?
Fuck him. Scott Gard can die a horrible death.
Don't even get Matt started on it.
Did that film do well, though?
I hope not.
How about Alan Moore?
Alan Moore? Oh, yeah. He's a cuckoo bird, but he's brilliant. And that's probably what makes him brilliant, is that he goes off on his little magical journeys and comes back
with
a story.
He'll take the check, but he wants his name off it.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Me for Vendetta. Right. You've crapped it up, but I will cash that check. That'll be fine.
What about you, Mr. Sheridan?
I'm trying to think about, I'm thinking more in terms of early 80s fantasy ones. One movie that I really liked that came out around the same time that Clash of the Titans did was Dragon Slayer.
Mm. Yeah, Dragon Slayer.
I like Dragon Slayer because at the time, Dragon Slayer was I think one of the first kind of, I guess it was go motion. It was like the next step. It was the next step past stop motion.
Yeah.
And at the time, I saw it in the theater, and I was blown away by that dragon.
Yeah.
And the way they fully realized that dragon as a character, and I kind of like the movie. It has a kind of dark grittiness to it. It takes a while to get going, but I enjoy it. Yeah. And like, so that one, I like that.
And you have said too that it was sort of like, didn't it come out? You said it came out around the time of like Clash of the Titans.
I think it did. And I remember
one.
Yeah.
Sort of 81.
Like. It sort of like showed that this is now where
because it was between classic stop motion but before CGI, it was like another. It was kind of like it was computer. It was like a computer behind the stop motion in a way, right? Like, it's hard to explain. But I just remember there were shots of that dragon. Like, wow, this is awesome.
I think the dragon in The Hobbit too was amazing. In the second Hobbit, Smaug is, and I hate pronouncing it, Smaug. I'm just like, whatever.
The Smaug monster.
But they really, I mean, the way they've fixed the CGI. And
I mean, one thing today I have to say, now the state of movie making today, the fantasy genre, you kind of pretty much can do anything. You know what I mean? Like, if they do it right, you know, you can kind of realize on the screen anything, you know?
Although, on the other hand, Now, my sort of thing that I would like to recommend, and I think maybe you guys turned me on to it, which is there's a series of films from the 60s in Japan called the Yokai Monster series. Mm-hmm. And you could argue that they're ghost stories, but they're really based on this old Japanese mythology of all these spirit creatures that are everywhere. And they did this series of these films that are sort of like H.R. Puffin stuff on acid, you know, they're like they're dark, like really though. Dark, yeah,
creepy.
Sort of everybody's in these weird ghost costumes, and they're clearly in crappy costumes.
And very revenge themed too.
And very yeah. revenge themed. Like,
did you ever see play a PS2 game called Stretch Panic? Have you ever seen that?
No.
It is also made in Japan, and it is about a little girl who goes into the demon world, and the demons are all giant-breasted lady demons with ponytails, and they're on these floating... The Japanese are out of their minds.
So, oh, yes.
They're on these floating platforms, them. And you can knock the demons off the platforms, but their boobs flatten out and turn into helicopter things and bring them back up to the platform. You got to run around them and pull their ponytails.
I'm playing this as soon as we're done here.
Stretch panic. Yeah. Stretch panic. Wow.
Wait, when you live in a country with a lot of flat chested women, boy, that's where your mind goes. If only I could fly your tits out of here.
Well, call me old fashioned, but I would say
the voice of reason.
I would say, as far as fantasy films go, we kind of touched about on this a little bit, and I would go with the Disney film, The Beauty and the Beast, but also there was a great French film called La Belle et la Bête. I think it was made in the
French. Oh, yeah. I love it.
Which,
yeah,
beautiful great. Movie.
Which is a fantastic fantasy film. This is where, you know, when you're walking through a room and there are these arms that are holding candelabras or something, and they all move, and the statues are open their eyes. I mean, it's a gorgeous film.
Beautiful black and
beautiful
white
film,
photography.
Beautiful black and white. And I would recommend that to anyone who is into, like, Beauty and the Beast. It's a great classic that I'm sure a lot of people don't know about.
Right,
definitely.
Right.
That's my recommendation.
Cool. That is a great one, and that is a great way to go on to James Gonis.
Who is our big beast.
No, right. This isn't really a fantasy genre so much, but one of my
favorite year? Yeah. Is that what you're going to
talk about? My God, you're psychic. Peplum, the Italian big spectacle ripoffs that were made on a show.
All the Hercules, right.
Steve Reeves. Mm-hmm. They're just so cheesy, and they're just
they have monsters. And
I love Xena.
They have the cheapest monsters.
Yeah, Xena. Yeah, yeah. That's definitely fantasy.
It's just
themed.
So obscure. You know, I love it, and it ended up leading to the spaghetti western genre after that, which I also love. So
what's it's called Peplum? What year did that one come out?
Well, it's a genre that started in the 50s, and it's Hercules, Samson, and all that brood.
Well, I think that's the end of our episode. You guys have been really, really fantastic, and
thanks for having me.
Yeah,
you guys.
And it's been so great to have Jackie Cation, visiting our shores.
Right.
So you
right.
guys
Thank
are
you,
wonderful,
Jackie.
And thanks for listening. And
keep America strong.
Watch horror films.
Yeah.
Bye, everybody. Monster Party.